So my name is Aaron Bedra. I work for Groupon, and I want to talk to you today a little bit about generative testing. Who here has tried generative testing in some form or another? Quick check. So yeah, the Haskell and Erlang, and the Aoki language has it, Scala. I think Java's got some frameworks, I think, too. So Clojure has something similar, and it's called test.generative, and it's in the Clojure, or under the Clojure banner. And I want to kind of talk about this today and explore some ideas about how you might use it and why you might use it. So I want to introduce a concept or a story here of the game Mastermind. Who's heard of the game Mastermind? To most of us, right? We have a board, we have guesses, and you make a guess, and it will tell you whether you've got exact matches or unordered matches. And then kind of you play until you get everything just right. So we're gonna build this game. We're gonna build it with three functions, and then we're gonna talk about testing it. So we'll start with the shell. Right? We want to feed it two collections of data, and we want to know our exact matches back. So we'll start with a simple shell. This is it. Two collections passed in, some work will be done. In order to get there, let's take a look at diff. So inside of Clojure, there's a space called Clojure.data, and it's got a function called diff. You feed it two collections, and it will return you the results. So the first is the matches in one, the matches in the second, and then the exact matches. The third piece there is actually the exact matches. That's actually exactly the data we want. So in one small, simple swing of our REPL, we can find out the exact matches. And if we turn that around, we build a function with it. So our function consists of our signature from before and a little let block that says we don't care about the first two things that come back from data diff. We just care about the third thing, matches. We want to kill the nils and give me the count. So how many of them are there? So in this case, we get two. We have two exact matches in this case. The unordered matches are a little bit different, right? The unordered matches, we want to know how many are in what position. So we're going to have to do a little bit more work here to get them, but not too much. So there's this great function called frequencies that tells us the number of times something appears in a collection. So if we do frequencies on our example guess and our example secret, we get that data. And then we can also select keys against the maps. We get two separate maps back, right? The number of things in the example secret and the number of things in the example guess. The end result is we want to merge those two data structures we get back into the lowest common set. So we merge them in, and all of a sudden we have the number of minimum matches. So we turn that around, we put it into a function called unordered matches. So we built the structure of our game in just a couple of small functions. Now, we can build our score function pretty easily, right? It's just exact and unordered matches. We pass a map back with the data. We have one small little trick here. Unordered matches is going to actually include exact matches, so we want to go ahead and pull those out so our counts don't get skewed that way. Otherwise, it's pretty straightforward. And so we've built this game now. We actually have a fully functioning MindMaster game in just a few short things. So it's nice little game, a few lines of code, maybe 20 lines of code. But we want to know how to test this, right? Where are the tests? We haven't tested anything yet. We've played at the REPL, and sometimes that's good enough, right? Sometimes we can experiment and know that we have tested it to some degree, right? We're really, in this case, only using a handful of Clojure, built-in Clojure functions and a small amount of logic. So I don't know. I guess I go both ways here on how much I'd really test this. But I certainly wouldn't write a bunch of unit tests for this because we have a big domain, right? We have lots of possibilities. I'm not sure about the edge cases, but we have a whole lot of possibilities. So we actually have a finite amount of possibilities here, right? We're talking about a secret and a guess made up of four different colors or four different elements. We actually have a very finite domain. And we can model the entire thing. We can actually test the entire thing. We wouldn't write 65,000 some odd unit cases. That would be ridiculous. We'd write one test. But to write that one test, we need to think about how we'd structure it. So I want to talk about the bits that go into thinking about modeling the entire domain. So this really cool Clojure contrib library called math.combinatorics exists for this exact purpose. We can actually print everything out. So what I'm doing here is taking a selection. I want to know all the combinations, basically every single pair possibility with the three elements R, G, and B. And it will give them all back to me. And that's cool, but our data is shaped differently, right? It's pairs Or it's two collections, right? So I can do it differently and say I want pairs of pairs. So give me the possibility of all pairs of pairs, given these three inputs. And I've highlighted all the details because the list is big. But you get the idea, right? I can generate everything. So we can turn this into a function, right? That's generate every single possible turn input, every single possible secret, and every single possible guess for our entire domain. And we can do it this way. This is a more generic function. We're not passing in the data. We want to pass the data into it. But score inputs is going to actually do all the secrets. We're going to feed it all the secrets and all the guesses, and it's going to score them all. So in the end, what we really want is something that we can give all the possible inputs to. It will score all the possible inputs and then give us a giant collection of all the data. So secret guess and then what the scoring function did to evaluate it. So we take it for a ride, right? So we generate all our inputs. We pass the result of that into score inputs. And all of a sudden, we have every single secret guess and score. And so that's a big, giant map of stuff. So how do we test that? What would we do here to test that? Look at it really hard. We can get a hammock and like hang out for a couple days. We could print it out to a file. So we could pull in closure print, bind a writer, and actually call print table on it. Right? We could have a whole list of things here. We could actually look at the whole thing. We could examine the entire thing in a nice, pretty printed out table. This is actually, we could test this way, right? Every time. We could spot check it, right? We could print this out, and we could spot check it and say, is this one right? Is that one right? People do this. This is actually a valid form of QA in some cases. Large automotive manufacturing, things like that. People do these kind of things, random spot checks, because there's just so much data you can't test it all. I don't know, right? I'm not quite sure about it yet. I still don't think I should write unit tests for it, but I think there's something more here. I want to now introduce test.generative. And I want to talk about maybe what we're missing and what we can use, or how we can use test.generative to solve this problem. So we've kind of described the domain. We've described, or we know how to generate all our inputs. We've captured the entire set of possibilities. Test.generative is going to let us experiment a little bit further and kind of harness all the things we've created, create some contracts, and then test it, and then make some actual real tests that we can automate and put in a continuous integration or something like that. So what I have here are some examples. We're going to pull in test.generative, and we're going to pull in the generators this time. So they have a bunch of built-in generators. So the first thing you see is genvec, genboolean. So give me a vector of Boolean values. The second is genhashmap, genbyte, genint. So give me a hash map with keys as bytes and values as integers. Gen me geometric. Gen me a list of integers. Gen me a list of uniform, or a list of integers and uniform values. Right? This is a whole bunch of stuff built into generative to kind of help you. But you don't have to stop there. You can actually define your own inputs as generative test functions. So we're going to introduce randomness. We're going to generate a vector that's filled with one of our G, B, and Y, and the size is going to be 4. So our constraint's 4 here. So generate me exactly what we want for secrets and guesses. And this is going to be the function we're going to use going forward. This is going to generate our secrets and our guesses. So one small little flip here, we can say here's exactly what we want to use as our input to our system. We know what it is. It's very easily defined. So we define the contracts, the laws of our system. There are certain things in our system that we know will always be true no matter what we do. And so now we introduce the idea of contracts. So we have a domain and we have contracts. And we have data. We've generated the data, we generated the domain. Now this is basically supporting our assumptions. So we want to know that when we score, the scoring is symmetric. It's bounded by the number of pegs. And reordering guesses does not change the match. So these are simple functions, right? We could probably get a little bit more fancy with our tests here. But these are just some simple ideas. So once we've defined these, we're actually going to give them a try to make sure they work, right? So we'll flip them through on the REPL, make sure that they do what we think they're going to do. But then you notice kind of how we're using it, right? Scoring is symmetric. We pass it a secret, a guess, and then we call score with secret and guess, right? So if you watch that, we can turn this into something real, right? We can actually create a test generative test based on that assumption. So we're going to call something called defspec, which is a generative function inside of generative. We're going to call it score invariance. We're going to call the function score. We're going to provide it a random secret and a random guess. But they're the same thing, so we're calling the same function. The tag just says, I want to invoke this versus one of the built-in test generative forms. And under that, we're going to make all of our assertions. So we're going to apply our contracts inside of this generative test. And we'll say, in the percent sign here, basically says, it's kind of an instant or in place replacement of what would end up calling the score function. So now we actually have a way to throw all our data at this test suite and let it go. So we can run these tests. There's lots of different ways to deal with this. If you just run test vars and you pass it a var in, which is the var we just defined, it's going to take all of your course and run the test for 10 seconds. So in this case, the default value is 10 seconds. It was able to run 1,700 some odd iterations on every core in 10 seconds. And you see the seed value there is a random seed, and you can actually control that if you want to. So you want to have isolated pockets of randomness. If you want to actually have no randomness in between your different CPUs, you can control that. So there's knobs for everything. You can increase the amount of time you run it. You can run it for 3 weeks. You can just basically try to exhaust the whole thing. So you can just try exhaustive testing. But the end result is that you get this nice set of tests that you can run indefinitely. And eventually, we're going to hit every single possible case in this domain. We know it's pretty limited, so we know we'll hit all the edge cases. But we have to know what happens when something fails, right? We're generating all this data. We have to be able to reuse the data and actually turn around and figure out what our problem is. So generative actually gives you one really nice tool, right? When something fails, if we redefine our scoring as bounded by a number of pegs and we put the wrong symbol in for our equality match, we're going to fail immediately. And we're going to see this failure 8 times because all 8 cores ran the first test and then failed out. But here's an example. The first thing you see is in this map there's something called form, and it has the exact thing that it put in. If you take the value of form and paste it into your REPL, you'll get your error. And so this is the test case that failed. Every time, you get the test case back that failed. So you go in, you push that through, you fix it, you try again. Something that some of the other test suites or generative testing frameworks have, narrowing or shrinking, doesn't exist in generative. So the failure is the failure, and you have to deal with it the way it is. The shrinking or narrowing idea is that it'll find that failure and then go ahead and try to find the simplest failure it can possibly find and give that back to you, which is really cool. It's not here yet, but I think it would be really cool to kind of introduce it. But nonetheless, you can actually take this, paste it in, and move on. So you can fix your test failures really, really easily, really quickly. But this is a really tiny case, right? It's a contrived case. It's simple. There's not much to it. There's no meat there. I could have probably accomplished what I think is confidence in my code by just looking at the code. It's just a few lines, and it's pretty simple. But there are times when it's not. Take, for instance, closures numerics, the entire numeric system, all the way it works. What we want to do is actually apply practical cases to that. So there are certain laws of mathematics that everything has to follow, right? And when we define that in a language, we want to know that it's correct. These things that I'm showing you actually came out of a patch doing Hello I know we're working on about in bigint and numeric operations before 1.3 hit. And these were kind of our guide rails, our lines in the road, if you will, to help us go through and test these and make sure things were still working properly. So we define tests like this that have well-defined formulas, right? Integer commutative laws has a well-defined formula. Likewise, so does integer associative laws. These are spelled out. You can find the formulas everywhere. So we can use this to test numerics and closure. Again, distributive laws, same thing. It applies everywhere, right? So we can actually build sets of rules of things we know to be true and prove our code, right? We can kind of ensure correctness this way. We can test patches to the language this way, right? If you look in test generative examples, you'll see test for hash. And in this case, hash had a collision bug a while ago. And some people were working on it, furiously submitting patches. And there were always little tiny bugs. And they couldn't figure out why they would submit a patch, and 30 seconds later, the exact error case that failed would get posted back to the mailing list. It was generative before it was released. But that was the way we tested it. These kind of things are so intense, and there's so much testing that has to be done, it's hard to get through all the cases. So when you can apply a domain and a set of constraints, you can find your edge cases a lot faster. Because you can't think of them, and no sane human being would write 65,000 unit tests for something, or 100,000 unit tests and try to maintain them, right? That's just not feasible. It's not scalable. It doesn't matter how many people you have writing tests. It's just not going to work. So it's a substitution, right? It's not a substitution for testing in general, but I think it's a substitution for testing systems and testing ideas, right? Testing inputs and outputs, right? You might isolate small portions of your code. This is more for testing the entire system and how it works. So this is an interesting idea. It's not new, but I actually want to introduce some things here for you to take away, because there's some really important ideas here. So the fluff here is this talk is actually online under GitHub. You can go and pull the slides here, and you can check out the Mastermind game in case you wanted to understand more of it. I didn't implement the entire Mastermind game, but I generated the ideas. Closure's test generative library. This example, the Mastermind example, is actually in the book that Stuart Halloway and I have just finished, the second edition of Programming Closure. So there's additional ideas and details in the book as well. But the meat here is some of the definitions of the QuickCheck library, and also John Hughes talking about QuickCheck. John Hughes has done some amazing things with generative or domain testing, and he's found like 20-year-old bugs in Erlang code with his amazing concurrent testing ideas, and his papers are really interesting. So I pointed one out here for you to check. Aoki has an interesting library inside of it, which is Olibini's JVM language. He's got something called iCheck, which has some interesting ideas in it as well. And so I linked right to the source code of that. Might have to read up on Aoki just a bit to get it, but it's a pretty simple language to grok. And you can kind of look at his ideas there. But also interesting is that these slides were generated or run using ClojureScript. So Stuart C.I. wrote a library called org.html slideshow, which takes Emacs org mode HTML output and turns it into slides. And so this is all run with ClojureScript. So I know that we have not much time, but the idea here is I wanted to get through this quickly and have some questions, because I think there should be a pretty good amount of questions to come out of this. So fire away. Yeah, so the question was, if we have type checking, will this help us with generative testing? I think so. I think optional typing would be a really awesome thing to have. I think Ambrose is actually working on optional typing for Closure. And so if we add that, that would be a great addition and actually help us an awful lot, both generate constraints and actually with our assertions as well. So I'm hoping that that ends up being what he does for his thesis and goes forward with it. I think we'd benefit really well from having that done. I think it's a great idea. Yeah, so statements about testing by contract and how that could help narrowing. And Focus wrote a library, is it Trammel? Is that the name of the contract library? So Focus has one out. I'm not sure the current state of it. Is Focus here? Okay, he's not here. If you find Focus, ask him more about it. But Trammel is his contract-based library. But yes, absolutely, contracts would be an interesting idea to help with narrowing in this case. Other questions? Okay, thank you very much.